डियर स्टूडेंट्स वेलकम बैक। बेटा लास्ट क्लास में मैंने आपको पीरियोडिक टेबल के बारे में थोड़ा बताया था। मैंने आपको बताए थे कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ मॉडर्न पीरियोडिक टेबल, मैंने आपको बताए थे मेरिट्स एंड डीमेरिट्स ऑफ मॉडर्न पीरियोडिक टेबल। थोड़ी सी बात मेंटली पीरियोडिक टेबल के डीमेरिट्स के बारे में भी हुई थी। मैंने आपको बताया था जो मॉडर्न पीरियोडिक टेबल है वो इलेक्ट्रॉनिक कॉन्फिग्रेशन के ऊपर बेस्ड है। सो इफ यू नो द इलेक्ट्रॉनिक कॉन्फिग्रेशन well means in case you know that n plus l rule and you know how to carry out electronic configuration by that method, modern periodic table will be easier for you to learn because all elements they are placed in this periodic table according to that electronic configuration only. Today what we are going to do, we'll move a bit ahead. In today's class we'll be talking about periodic properties. आज पीरियोडिक प्रॉपर्टीज के बारे में आपको बताऊंगा। हम लोग देखेंगे ये पीरियोडिक प्रॉपर्टीज होती क्या है। सो टुडे विल डू पीरियोडिक प्रॉपर्टीज। पीरियोडिक प्रॉपर्टी की अगर मैं बात करूं तो कुछ प्रॉपर्टी ऐसी होती हैं जो एक रेगुलर इंटरवल ऑफ एटॉमिक नंबर के बाद रिपीट करती है। There are certain properties which get repeated after a regular interval of atomic number. Jaise atomic radii, ionization energy, the value of electron gain enthalpy, the value of electronegativity, it gets repeated. There is a similarity. Like I give you one example. Suppose I talk about the second period. In second period, lithium has got the largest atomic radii. And as you move from lithium to beryllium to boron to carbon to nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, this atomic radius keeps on decreasing. But when you move back to the third period, it again increases. So in second period, lithium is the largest atom. Likewise, in third period, sodium has got the largest atomic radii. In fourth period, potassium has got the largest atomic radii. So you will see that there is a repetition in the atomic radii. The largest atomic radii in every period belongs to the first group elements. तो ये जो repetition हो रहा है किसी property में, इसको बोलते हैं हम periodic property. क्योंकि एक regular period of atomic number के बाद ये repeat हो रही है. इसी तरह से हम कह सकते हैं कि जो first group के element हैं, they have got the lowest, the first group elements have the lowest value of ionization energy. So lithium in its period has got the lowest value of ionization energy. Likewise, sodium in its period has got the lowest value of ionization energy. Potassium in its period has got the lowest value of ionization energy. So when you are moving from left to right, from lithium to beryllium to boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, this ionization energy is increasing, but then again it will decrease. तो एक regular interval के बाद ionization energy कम हो रही है। इसी तरह से electronegativity, electron gain enthalpy, ये सब periodic property हैं। तो periodic, what are periodic property? These are the properties which get repeated after a regular interval of atomic number. The properties which get repeated after a regular interval of atomic number are known as periodic property. And as far periodic properties are concerned, here in this class we'll be studying about four periodic properties, that is atomic radii, the ionization energy, the electron gain enthalpy and the electronegativity. In char periodic properties ke bare mein hum baat karenge. To sabse pehle hum log baat karenge jo pehli periodic property hum log padhenge, that is atomic रेडियाई, एटॉमिक रेडियाई। हम लोग इसके अंदर पढ़ेंगे एटॉमिक रेडियाई क्या होता है, कितने तरीके के एटॉमिक रेडियाई होते हैं, उनका पीरियोडिक टेबल में क्या ट्रेंड होता है, किन फैक्टर्स के ऊपर वो डिपेंड करते हैं। इफ आई टॉक अबाउट एटॉमिक रेडियाई, सपोज आई गॉट एन एटम, से दिस इज द न्यूक्लियस ऑफ एन एटम, यू गॉट फर्स्ट शेल, देन यू गॉट सेकंड शेल, थर्ड शेल, फोर्थ शेल, एंड सपोज फोर्थ शेल इज द वैलेंस शेल, दिस इज द आउटर मोस्ट शेल। Then the distance from the center of the nucleus to the outermost shell is known as the atomic radii. Now how to define it? Because we know that electron is not a particle. हम लोगों ने structure of atom में पढ़ा है that electron has got a dual behavior. Sometime electron it behaves like a particle and sometime it behaves like a wave. It basically depends on the type of experiment we are conducting. So how to define atomic radii? We can say atomic radii is the distance. Atomic radii is the distance from the center of the nucleus of an atom to the shell where the presence of the last electron is felt. तो जहां तक आपको ये लगा कि negative charge यहां तक है, जहां तक आपको नेगेटिव चार्ज फील हुआ है वहां तक का डिस्टेंस जो है उसको हम एटॉमिक रेडियस कहते हैं। सो इट इज द डिस्टेंस फ्रॉम द सेंटर ऑफ द न्यूक्लियस ऑफ एन एटम टू द शेल वेयर द प्रेजेंस ऑफ द लास्ट इलेक्ट्रॉन इज फेल्ट। सो दैट इज एटॉमिक रेडियस। इसमें हम लोग बोलते कैसे, इसको कंप्लीट करते हैं डेफिनेशन को। इट इज द डिस्टेंस फ्रॉम द सेंटर ऑफ द न्यूक्लियस टू द शेल वेयर द प्रेजेंस ऑफ द लास्ट इलेक्ट्रॉन इज फेल्ट इन एन आइसोलेटेड गैसियस एटम, एक अकेले एटम के अंदर। दुनिया के किसी भी चीज का अकेला एटम होगा वो हमेशा गैसियस स्टेट में ही कहलाता है। सो इट इज द डिस्टेंस फ्रॉम द सेंटर ऑफ द न्यूक्लियस टू द शेल वेयर द प्रेजेंस ऑफ द लास्ट इलेक्ट्रॉन इज फेल्ट इन एन आइसोलेटेड गैसियस एटम। सो दैट इज एटॉमिक रेडियस। नाउ वी विल टॉक अबाउट द टाइप ऑफ एटॉमिक रेडियस। टाइप ऑफ एटॉमिक रेडियस, देखिए एटॉमिक रेडियस को मेजर कर पाना बहुत मुश्किल है बिकॉज एटम डज नॉट एग्जिस्ट इन इंडिपेंडेंट स्टेट। सो इट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू मेजर द एटॉमिक रेडियस। यू नो यू माइट हैव लर्न दिस थिंग इन योर जूनियर स्टैंडर्ड लाइक 9th or 10th दैट एटम इज इनकेपेबल ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंट एग्जिस्टेंस। एटम वेरी रेडली कंबाइन्स विद अनदर एटम टू फॉर्म अ मॉलिक्यूल। दैट अनदर एटम कैन बी of the same type or of different type. So you have homoatomic molecule and heteroatomic molecule. So atom does not exist independently. Then how to measure atomic radius and what is this atomic radius then? We'll see, we can divide these atomic radii in three main parts. That is covalent, metallic, van der Waals. But apart from these three, I'll also teach you ionic radii. What is ionic radii and how to calculate it. So we'll talk about type of atomic radii. First I'll teach you covalent radii. So what is a covalent radii? See, if I talk about some non-metals like hydrogen, chlorine, bromine, oxygen, nitrogen, you'll see that these atoms, the atom of these elements, they does not exist in the free state. They combine with other atom to form a molecule. Suppose I'm talking about this molecule of hydrogen, and suppose this is a hydrogen atom. It will combine with another hydrogen atom to form a hydrogen molecule. So what we'll say, what is this covalent radii then? See, these two hydrogen atoms, they are joined together by a covalent bond. If I can calculate the distance between the center of the nucleus of these two atoms, I can call it covalent diameter. And if I divide that covalent diameter by 2, I will get covalent radii. So what we can say, covalent radii is half the distance joining the center of the nucleus of two atoms which are joined together by a covalent bond. So covalent radii is half the distance between the center of the nucleus of two atoms which are joined together by a covalent bond. तो कोवलेंट बॉन्ड से अगर दो एटम जुड़े हुए हैं उनके न्यूक्लियस के सेंटर का जो डिस्टेंस है उसको अगर आप आधा कर दो उसको हम कोवलेंट रेडियाई कहते हैं बच्चों। लेकिन कोवलेंट रेडियाई में आपको एक चीज ध्यान रखनी है कि कोवलेंट रेडियाई जो होता है वो एक्चुअल एटॉमिक रेडियाई से थोड़ा छोटा होता है, क्योंकि यहां पर जो बीच वाला स्पेस है आप देख रहे हैं वो कॉमन है दोनों के लिए। इतना स्पेस और ऐड होना चाहिए, ये वॉल्यूम और ऐड हो जानी चाहिए, तब एग्जैक्ट एटॉमिक रेडियाई आएगा, क्योंकि हमने ये कॉमन लिया दोनों के लिए। So covalent radii is slightly smaller than the actual atomic radii. So what is covalent radii once again? It is half the distance joining the center of the nucleus of two atoms which are joined together by a covalent bond. And covalent radii is found to be smaller than the actual atomic radii. After covalent, we'll talk about ionic radii. For this, I'll give you one example. For this, I'll give you a very common example, that is of sodium chloride. Suppose I'm talking about sodium, first shell, second shell, and here I have the third shell. The first shell has got 2 electrons, the second shell has got 8 electrons, and the third shell has got 1 electron in case of sodium. Likewise, if I talk about chlorine, nucleus, first shell, second shell, and third shell. The first shell has got 2 electron, the second shell has got 8 electron, and the third shell has got 7 electrons. So this is a chlorine atom. Now in making sodium chloride, the sodium atom loses an electron. It will become Na positive. This electron will go to chlorine and it will become chloride. So when I talk about Na positive, here you have the nucleus, you have the first shell having 2 electrons, and now you have the second shell having 8 electrons only. So this is Na positive ion this time. Likewise, if I talk about chloride ion, in chloride ion, we have an excess electron. So you have got 8 electron in the outermost shell. 8 electron in the outermost shell. This is chloride ion. So you'll notice one thing, that since sodium is losing an electron, its atomic radius will decrease. It is gaining positive charge. Initially, what was happening, sodium was having 11 negative charge and 11 positive charge. 11 electron and 11 proton. After losing an electron, it will have 10 electrons, but protons are same, that is 11. Sodium ke andar 10 electron reh jayenge, aur sodium mein proton utna hi rahenge, 11, kyunki usne ek electron lose kara hai. So the number of proton is increasing, or it is exceeding the number of electrons. The number of proton is exceed the number of electron by 1 unit. Hence, the force of attraction on the electrons will increase. They will come closer to the nucleus. So the atomic radii will decrease. So we can say the atomic radii of Na positive is smaller than Na. There are two factors responsible for that. The first thing, the number of protons is more in the nucleus as compared to the number of electrons. So the effective nuclear charge is increasing. The force of attraction is increasing and the electrons, they are coming closer to the nucleus. So the atomic radii is decreasing. And the second factor is, after losing an electron, the outermost shell of sodium has vanished. Now since the outermost shell has vanished, that means it is now Na positive has got lesser number of shells as compared to Na. If you see, sodium has got 3 shells, whereas Na positive has got only 2 shells. Since the number of shells has decreased, the atomic radii has also decreased. So we can say, see, after losing an electron, an atom forms a cation. So we can say that cationic radii is smaller than the actual atomic radii. And cationic radii is smaller than the actual atomic radii because of two factors. The first, after losing electron, the number of protons exceeds the number of electrons. So the electrons, they will experience more attraction from the nucleus and they will come closer to the nucleus. The second thing, after losing electron, in most of the atoms, the outermost shell vanishes. So the number of shells decreases and the atomic radii also decreases. That's why the cationic radii is smaller than the actual atomic radii. Now let us talk about the anionic radii. If I talk about anionic radii, the anionic radii is generally larger than the actual atomic radii. Jo bhi atomic radii hai, anionic radii usse thoda bada hota hai. Why this anionic radii is larger than the actual atomic radii? Because now chlorine has got more number of electrons as compared to the number of protons. Initially, chlorine had 17 negative charge, means 17 electrons and 17 positive protons. But now what is happening? You have got 18 electrons but 17 protons. That means the electron number is exceeding now. You have got more number of electrons in chlorine. That's why you got a chloride ion, Cl negative. Now, since there are more number of electrons, these electrons, they will experience inter-electronic repulsion. They will experience a repulsion among themselves. My dear students, we have already learned about the inter-electronic repulsion in chapter 2, structure of atom, where we learned that although electrons, they are negatively charged, but in an orbital, when you place two electrons, they does not experience the repulsion. Because if one of the electrons is spinning clockwise, the another one will spin anti-clockwise. So if one is generating the north pole of the magnetic field, the another one is generating the south pole, and they will experience attraction. That's a different thing, no doubt about that. They have some attraction. But literally, electrons, they are negatively charged. And literally, they have some repulsion among them. Now, when you have got more number of electrons in a shell, they will experience more repulsion among them. Once the shell is fulfilled, this repulsion becomes very prominent. Now, chlorine initially had 7 electrons in the valence shell. Now, when one electron is added, you got 8 electrons in the valence shell. The shell is fulfilled. So, inter-electronic repulsion will increase. And as a result of that, the electronic cloud will expand. The electronic cloud will expand. The atomic radii will increase. That's why anions, they generally have a larger ionic radii as compared to their atomic radii. So, here in this case, Cl negative is larger than Cl. So, cationic radii is smaller and anionic radii is larger. How to define this ionic radii? By now, we know what is ionic radii, means how ions they are formed, what is cation and what is anion, what will happen to the cationic radii, it will be smaller than the actual atomic radii, what will happen to the anionic radii, that will be larger than the actual atomic radii. But how to define an ionic radii? Well, the definition for an ionic radii is that it is the distance from the center of the nucleus. It is the distance from the center of the nucleus to the shell where the presence of the last electron is felt in an ion. So it is the distance from the center of the nucleus to the shell where the presence of the last electron is felt in an ion. So it can be a cation or an anion. The distance from the center of the nucleus to the shell where the presence of the last electron is felt in the ion, that is the ionic radii. The cationic radii is generally smaller than the actual atomic radii, and the anionic radii is generally larger than the actual atomic radii. After this, after ionic radii, we'll talk about the third type of radii, that is the metallic radii. Well, before starting with the metallic radii, before learning about the metallic, the factors or the definition of metallic radii, we had to have a look at the bonding in metals. As far the bonding in metals is concerned, that is a bit different from non-metals. In non-metals, you have covalent bond. Had there been a covalent bond between metals, their electrons wouldn't have been in the free state. They wouldn't have been good conductor of electricity. We know that metals, they are good conductor of electricity. That means there is, see, ionic compounds, they are generally good conductor of electricity, but metals, they does not have ionic bond, because all metal atoms, they have same electronegativity. Suppose I have large number of sodium atoms. All of them, they have same electronegativity. For the formation of ionic bond, you had to have difference, a large difference in electronegativity. When they have same type of electronegativity, that means a covalent bond is formed between them. They have same electronegativity, they'll form bond by sharing of electrons. And if covalent bond is formed between them, covalent bond is not a good conductor of electricity. So they shouldn't conduct electricity, but they do conduct electricity. Now the question comes to our mind, when they have got same electronegativity, they should have covalent bond among them. And in case they will have covalent bond among them, they should not have been good conductor of electricity, but they are good conductor of electricity. So what type of bonding we have got in metals? So first we have to learn it. See, metal atoms, they are very large in atomic radii. So if I talk about a metal atom, suppose this is the last shell of a metal atom. Likewise here also, first shell, then I have second shell, then I have the third shell. Then here again, I have got another metal atom. Second shell, then I have the third shell. Likewise, large number of metal atoms, they are joined together. So if we have a look at a metallic rod, imagine this is a metallic rod. If I have a look at a metallic rod, there are large number of atoms joined together like this. Bacho, this part, these electrons, they are free electrons. They are far off from the nucleus. They're very far from the nucleus. Now, since metals, they have a larger atomic radii. Metals generally have a larger atomic radii. So these bonded electrons, they are very far off from the nucleus. When they are away from the nucleus, the force of attraction from the nucleus is very weak on them. Since the force of attraction is very weak on them, these electrons, they are free to move. They can move out. Likewise, this electron, it can also move out. So these bonded electrons, which are very far off from the nucleus, they experience very less effective nuclear charge from the nucleus. They are free to move. So if you apply a small EMF, these electrons, they'll start traveling. They'll start moving. They are the free electrons, leaving behind the cation. If these bonded electrons, they'll start moving, what you'll get? You'll get M positive, here also M positive, here also M positive. Cation is what you'll get. So if I have a look at a metallic rod, if I look at the metallic rod, in this metallic rod, you have large number of cations like this. These are not nucleuses which I'm drawing. These are the cations. Don't consider them as nucleus. And between these cations, you have free electrons. So these are the free electrons, the bonded electrons, which are holding them together. This model is known as electron C model. According to this model, if you have a look at a metal, it contains large number of free electrons which can move here and there. They are free. They are free to move. And in this ocean of free electrons, you have cations embedded in between. So you have different cations. Atoms with positive charge, they are embedded and their electrons, they are free to move everywhere. This is known as electron C model. So according to electron C model, there are large number of free electrons in a metallic rod. And the cations, they are embedded in that ocean of free electrons. These electrons, they can easily move. Now, how to define a metallic radii? The center of the distance between the center of the nucleus of two neighboring, we call them, these cations, they are known as Carnells. The cations which are embedded in the ocean of free electrons, they are known as Carnell. Half the distance, this one, I'll call it metallic diameter. Half the distance between the center of the nucleus of two Carnells is known as the metallic radii. Again, what is metallic radii? It is half the distance between the nucleus of two neighboring Carnells. Carnells means cations. If you remove those free electrons, you are left with the cation, that is Carnell. So metallic radii, once again, you will have metallic diameter divided by 2. And what is metallic diameter? We can say that metallic radii is half the distance between the nucleus of the two neighboring Carnells. So here you can see this covalent radii. This covalent radii is formed between two hydrogen atoms. See, these two hydrogen atoms, they are joined together by a covalent bond. The distance between the nucleus of these two hydrogen atoms is known as covalent diameter. Half of this we consider as covalent radii. Okay, here you can see ionic radii. You can see that Na positive is smaller and Cl negative is larger. As I taught you that cations, they are generally smaller and anions, they are generally larger. So this is all about ionic radii. This is metallic radii. Na, large number of metal atoms, they are joined together. So between them are some free electrons. So if these free electrons, they'll move out, you are left with carnans. So half the distance joining the center of nucleus of two neighboring carnans is metallic radii. Here also you can see this. Covalent radii you can see, and this is metallic radii. So covalent, as I taught you, that covalent radii is generally smaller than the actual atomic radii. But if we talk about metallic radii, that is nearly equal to the actual atomic radii. Covalent radii, in aluminium you will have metallic radii. Now I will teach you something about the van der Waals radii also, after metallic radii. So we'll talk about this. By now what we have done, what is atomic radii, what is covalent radii, ionic radii, metallic radii, and now we'll talk about van der Waals radii. Van der Waals radii. Well, van der Waals radii is generally applicable on noble gases, the inert gases. Helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon. These gases, they does not form bond because we call them stable gases or inert gases. They does not have a tendency of forming bond. Then how come their atoms, they are held together? Well, noble gases, suppose this is a gas atom. Likewise here also, this is a gas atom. Here also, I have a gas atom. These gas atoms, the noble gas atoms, they are held together by weak force of attraction known as the van der Waals forces. Van der Waals forces, they were discovered by van der Waals, that's why we call them van der Waals forces. So noble gases, the 18th group elements, the inert gases, they are held together by weak van der Waals forces. If they are not forming bond, then what we'll do? We'll calculate the distance between the center of the nucleus of two neighboring noble gas atoms held together by van der Waals force. Two neighboring noble gas atoms, the distance between the center of the nucleus of two neighboring noble gas atoms which are held together by van der Waals forces is known as van der Waals diameter. So we can call it diameter. Van der Waals diameter divided by 2 will give you van der Waals radii. So we can say that noble gases, they does not have a tendency of forming bond with themselves. That's why noble gas atoms, they are held together by weak van der Waals forces. The distance between the center of the nucleus of two noble gas atoms is known as the van der Waals diameter, and half of this distance will give us van der Waals radii. Van der Waals radii, dear student, as for van der Waals radii is concerned, it is found to be slightly larger than the actual atomic radii, because when you are calculating van der Waals radii, you are including this empty space also. So van der Waals radii is slightly larger, like covalent radii is slightly lesser. Likewise, in the same way, the van der Waals radii is slightly larger than the actual atomic radii. So if we write down a trend, we'll see that covalent radii is the smallest one. Then you have metallic radii, which is nearly equal to the actual atomic radii. Then you have van der Waals radii, which is larger than the actual atomic radii. So these are the different types of atomic radii. In today's class, what we have learned, what is atomic radii, what are the different type of atomic radii, which among them is the larger one and which among them is smaller. So that's all for this class. And in the next class, we'll be studying about their factors affecting atomic radii and their trend in the periodic table. So that's all for this class. Thank you very much.